Aloha everyone and welcome back to the Kaimana Conservation Channel. For those of you guys that haven't been here before, my name is Jessica and I am a professional marine biologist that lives and works in Maui, Hawaii. So this episode is going to be the third video in a three-part series on corals. The first video that we did covered what are corals. The second video went over coral bleaching and essentially what is coral bleaching and how it impacts the environment as well as us. And here in the third one, we are going to be going into how to help corals. So that we're going to kind of split it into two. We're going to cover how to help corals while you are actually at the beach or on the ocean. In the vicinity of corals, and there's going to be a second section or the second half of it, which is going to be how to help corals from your own home, no matter what your proximity is to the ocean. If you haven't seen the first or second video of this little three-part series, I would definitely recommend you guys watching the first two videos first, and that is because in the first video we talk about what are corals and how they work biologically, which is going to be really helpful in order to understand the second video, which is about coral bleaching and explains to you guys what coral bleaching is, as well as how it impacts the environment as well as us. And that all kind of goes together and helps us to understand this final video, which is how you guys can help to save coral reefs. So if you haven't seen those videos yet, I would definitely recommend going and watching those either before this video or immediately after. It'll definitely make more sense to you guys that way. So I think it's fairly obvious by now, for those of you guys that have been watching these videos, that I love the ocean. I decided for it to be my profession. And chances are, if you are watching these videos, you like the ocean as well. So I think you guys can probably relate when I say that the first thing that I asked when I finally began to understand and grasp the concept of global climate change and coral bleaching was, how do I fix this? Like, I desperately wanted to be able to make an impact and reduce my impact on the reef when I realized the severity of the situation. Now that I am a professional marine biologist, I have had the opportunity to accumulate all kinds of fun facts and little tidbits and cool knowledge from other professionals and from reading. And there's so many amazing ways to help reduce your impact on the ocean and on the reefs, just in the little actions that you do or don't do that can indirectly or not so indirectly impact the reef. So the information that I'm going to be telling you guys today are things that I tell visitors here on the island, either at the Ocean Center or on the boats, or even people that I interact with at the beach, and I tell them all the time. So you guys can kind of take this into your information arsenal, and if you do end up either traveling to Hawaii or anywhere else in the world that has tropical coral reefs, you will know this in the future. So we're going to go into some of the top recommendations from coral conservation experts on how to save the oceans, including our precious coral reefs. Like I mentioned at the beginning, we're going to split this into two sections. So this is going to be the first section, which we're going to call at the ocean. So essentially when you are visiting a coastal community or if you are physically on the beach or on the reef. So the first helpful hint is practice reef etiquette. So it is extremely important that when you are visiting an ocean environment, or any environment for that matter, but specifically a coral reef environment, that you do not touch anything. So you want to make sure that you don't accidentally or intentionally kick any coral or stand on any part of the reef. You don't want to touch any coral or any inhabitants of the reef, and you definitely don't want to grab onto anything. So make sure that you don't touch anything on the reef is essentially the concept of reef etiquette. The reason behind this is because, especially in the case of corals, accidentally or intentionally touching corals can actually be fatal for the coral. So what happens is the coral, like I mentioned in the first video, is just a paper thin layer of tissue over a hard calcium carbonate skeleton. And when you bump into that coral, you can actually squish the living tissue and basically cut itself on its own skeleton. And unfortunately, this can be really painful for you as well, and it is fatal for the coral. If you get the urge to stand up or take a break while you're out snorkeling, make sure that you bring a flotation device with you. They sell life jackets or pool noodles, or a lot of boat tours will offer those to you guys. They've got like little belts that you can wear to help you stay afloat and to make sure you guys don't get tired. Do not be prideful and refuse it if you genuinely think that you might need it. You will not see a tour operator out here get angry at you faster than if you refuse a flotation device and then 20 minutes later they see you standing on the reef. It's really upsetting and they have every right to be upset with you. So definitely make sure that you bring a flotation device with you if you think that you're going to get tired, especially if you've never snorkeled before. Sometimes being in the ocean for the first time and snorkeling for the first time can be a little exhausting. And not only is it helpful to have a flotation device with you as a little bit of a security blanket and make sure you feel comfortable, but also if you get tired, you can just relax onto that instead of feeling the urge to stand on the reef. Helpful hint number two is gonna be making sure that you choose non-toxic sun protection. So coming out to Hawaii or any type of tropical area in which there are coral reefs, it's hot out. It's hot and the sun is going to be beaming down. For the people who are not used to living close to the equator in tropical environments, you might not be used to having that much sun rays on your skin, and it can be very damaging. However, it can be a little bit of a daunting task, especially with the new information that's been coming out about the harmful chemicals that are in certain chemical sunscreens. And one of the number one questions that I get asked is like, how do I choose a sunscreen? I want to make sure that I'm making the right decision. I just don't know how. So it is a very large and kind of complicated topic. I could make, again, a whole video just on this topic. But for the sake of time, I'll just give you guys a few like easy to follow helpful hints, and that'll help you guys to be able to make smart sunscreen and sun protection choices in the future. So the first thing to remember when you're considering a form of sun protection is to avoid chemical sunscreens. Chemical sunscreens have already been determined to be toxic to corals and humans for that matter. You shouldn't use chemical sunscreens. It's not good for anybody. But they have definitely been confirmed in various scientific studies to be bad for corals. So there are certain chemicals that are in chemical sunscreens, such as avobenzone and oxybenzone, that are known to be endocrine disruptors, which basically means that the coral goes infertile and it can't grow anymore. And high concentrations of these chemicals in the water can exacerbate those problems. So as you can imagine, Hawaii is a very popular tourism destination. Obviously, it's COVID right now, so the numbers are a bit skewed for 2020. But to give you an idea, back in 2019, so just last year, the Hawaiian Islands received over 10 million visitors to the island, most of which went to the beach and went to the into the water at least once. So as you guys can imagine, it doesn't take rocket science to figure out that many people visiting the islands, if a good portion of those people are not choosing sustainable sunscreens, then most of those toxic chemicals are getting washed off of their bodies and onto our reefs. So if you shouldn't use a chemical sunscreen, then you need to find an alternative, and that is a mineral sunscreen. Mineral sunscreens are basically a physical barrier instead of a chemical barrier, which I will get into in a different video. There's too much to go into for the chemistry of sunscreens. But the mineral sunscreen is definitely a better option than a chemical sunscreen. Mineral sunscreens are shown to cause far less damage to reefs compared to chemical sunscreens. So learning how to tell the difference between a mineral sunscreen or a physical sunscreen versus a chemical sunscreen takes a little bit of practice. It takes a little bit of detective work, which I know can be a bit overwhelming. There are a lot of sunscreen companies out there that falsely advertise themselves as being reef safe, even though they do contain the exact same harmful chemicals as some of the other non-reef safe sunscreens, because they are actually not reef safe. So you need to make sure that you do your homework and look at the ingredients to make sure that you're not buying the wrong one. Now, I know this can be a little bit intimidating. I've had people tell me, like, oh my gosh, like, do I need to become a chemist and understand all these like massive chemical words on the back of my bottles? No, you don't. Don't worry. There is actually a much easier way of determining whether or not your sunscreen is legitimately reef safe. And that is to flip over the bottle and to look at the ingredients list stay with me. I know you guys are already starting to panic. This is super simple. There's only two things that you need to look for, and that is zinc or titanium. Hopefully you guys can just commit those two to memory. It's not nearly the same as like some of the long words on the chemical sunscreen list. Sometimes only one of those is in a mineral sunscreen. That is literally the only ingredient in the entire bottle. So I actually do have, I have some sunscreen bottles here to show you guys to prove that I am right. The first one we're gonna do is a non-reef safe sunscreen. Banana boat. It's a very popular sunscreen. I know I used to use it growing up because I didn't know any better. I know quite a few people that use it. The reason that I have it is because I confiscated it off of somebody who was getting ready to use it and then go onto the reef. Don't worry, I was nice about it and I gave them a better sunscreen and they were happy to be rid of it. But that is why I am in possession of a banana boat sunscreen. But this is a chemical sunscreen, and the way that you can tell that it is not reef safe is if you look at the back. As you guys can see here, right where my fingernail is the ingredients list, and pretty much right at the top is avobenzone, which is not a good material for the reef. So that is an example of a non-reef safe sunscreen. And I have another reef safe sunscreen. This is a face sunscreen, which is why its bottle is so small. But I'm gonna do the same thing. I'm gonna show you the ingredients list. As you guys can see, it is a very short ingredients list, and it has titanium and zinc. So you can see both of those, titanium and zinc. That means it is a true, legitimate reef safe mineral sunscreen. Another hint, if you guys are too intimidated by the ingredients list, is if it is a spray, it almost definitely is not a reef safe sunscreen. And last but not least is using a physical barrier instead of a sunscreen for your sun protection. So this is essentially just using long sleeve shirts or rash guards or sun gaiters that go up over your nose or up over your forehead. You can use hats, sunglasses, swim tights, swim skins, which are like the full body ones, like a wetsuit but thinner, as well as wetsuits. So there's lots of different clothing options and accessories. I actually have one right here. This is my rash guard from the Maui Ocean Center. So this is the most sustainable method of keeping harmful chemicals out of the water. And this is the best sun protection that you can provide yourself as well. So I would definitely recommend that if you were looking at all of the options, if you wanna get a mineral sunscreen for like your nose or your tops of your ears or things that stick out from these materials, definitely go for that. But I would say a majority of your body can be protected by using a physical barrier instead of a sunscreen. I haven't had to buy any sunscreens in a really long time. So it's really economical for the wallet, and it's really sustainable as far as your chemical output as well. You're not washing off any chemicals into the reef. Helpful tip number three is leave nature as you found it. So I know it is super tempting for people to go to the beach and want to collect things that they find at the beach or in the water, but definitely don't do that. They could be alive in the case of coral fragments. Even if it's just a piece that's not necessarily attached to the bottom, it could still be a living piece of coral. Additionally, there could be things inside that are still alive. There might be like little worms or tiny microscopic crustaceans. You never know what's in there, and unfortunately sometimes you don't find out until it's too late. You've removed it from the water, you take it home, and then it starts to stink. If it starts to stink, that is because there was something alive in there and it has since died, and that is what smells. It's the same rule that goes for shells. I know shells are a really fun thing for people to pick up. I grew up being an avid shell collector, so I definitely understand the desire, but the fact of the matter is those shells are very useful in an ocean ecosystem. They oftentimes have animals living in them. Even if they look empty, sometimes they are not. The same thing applies. Sometimes you don't find out until it's too late. Not to mention, even dead pieces of coral or coral fragments or shells that are actually empty at the time are still really, really vital to a coral reef ecosystem, and you definitely shouldn't remove them. All the little crushed up pieces of rubble create habitat for animals that live on the bottom or the benthic environment. Those coral pieces can get crushed up into sand, which is what creates our beaches and our the basis of our seafloor and our reef. So obviously sand production is really, really important. And as far as the animals are concerned, like same thing with shells, that's what they use to hide in. Like you wanna make sure that you leave those kinds of things because there are hermit crabs and even octopus. There are certain species of octopus that are really tiny that use shells to hide. And if we take all of those shells, then there's gonna be nothing left for those organisms to hide in, and therefore they're not gonna be able to survive. There's nothing hiding them from predators. Additionally, the removal of coral and shells from the ocean can be seen as extremely disrespectful depending on where you are in their culture. Hawaii is actually a really, really good example. It is not okay culturally to take a coral or a shell out of the water. In the Hawaiian culture, their creation story actually began with a coral polyp. So corals are revered as this very important species, and removing corals and coral fragments from the water is considered to be extremely disrespectful. The fourth helpful hint is leave no trace. Some of you guys who spend a lot of time in the environment may have already heard of this one, but leave no trace just means that whenever you visit a natural area, that you leave nothing behind that would indicate to anybody else visiting that there was ever a person there in the first place. Leave no trace is specifically referring to people and their garbage. So we want to make sure that whenever you are visiting the beach or the reef, that you are taking any rubbish that you have accumulated since you've been there and you bring it with you and dispose of it properly. It is so, so disheartening when I see people disrespect nature and our oceans by leaving their trash in it. It's really sad. And honestly, if you can think of it, I've seen it. I've seen it all. I've seen people throw their takeout food and their plastic waste and their cigarettes out of car windows right next to the beach. I've seen people have a picnic on the beach parks and in the beach and just leave all of their trash behind because they didn't want to, you know, pick it all up. I've seen people just let their food wrappers blow away in the wind toward the ocean because they couldn't be bothered to go catch it. I've even seen people take their disposable cups and cutlery and literally throw it overboard while driving into Molokini Crater here in Maui, which is our most respected and revered protected site here in Maui. I've literally seen people throw trash into the marine reserve. So please, 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 remove your trash from the beach and from the ocean. Take it with you. Do not leave it at the beach. There are thousands, literally thousands of marine animals deaths that are recorded every year, which are attributed to plastic. Thousands of animals die every year because of plastic. There's all kinds of things that can happen. They can either get wrapped up or entangled in the plastic. They can accidentally swallow it and choke on it. Or if it makes it past and they don't choke on it, the accumulation of trash in their stomach can sometimes trick an animal into thinking it's full and then it will actually starve. So, as you guys can tell, I am extremely passionate about this topic. I think marine debris is one of my more passionate topics when it comes to marine conservation. I could make a bunch more videos on that topic alone. Let me know if that's something you guys would be interested in. But long story short, make sure that you leave no trace. Don't leave any rubbish. Okay, tip number five, making sure that you support conscious reef-friendly businesses. So here in Hawaii, as well as other places in the world that are coastal communities to tropical reef ecosystems, it is extremely important to vote with your dollar or to support businesses that you stand behind their mission and their reef-friendly practices by paying for those services. It's essentially a supply and demand situation. And especially as a visitor, doing your homework on who is a reef-friendly business and who is not is the difference between harming the reef and helping the reef with your business. There are hundreds of businesses, tourism operators, educational institutions on these islands, and it is very important that you choose a reef-friendly business that is supporting ecotourism and sustainability practices and explores the reef and supports the reef instead of exploiting it. And last but not least is hint number six, and that is supporting reef-friendly boating practices. Now this is a little bit more of a particular one, kind of a shoot-off from number five on sustainable tourism and reef-friendly businesses. It's specifically for people who are intending to go on a boat tour, which is very popular out here in Hawaii. It is very important that you support reef-friendly boating practices, which simply means that whatever you're doing on the boat is going to be sustainable and friendly to the reef. For example, here in Hawaii, all of our boats, or at least our big tourism operator boats, they do what's called a mooring instead of throwing out an anchor. And the mooring is essentially a ball that is already and permanently attached to the seafloor in a safe and sustainable way. And then all that boat has to do is throw a line in the water and then tie around the mooring ball, or wrap around the mooring ball and tie it back up to the boat. And then that means that they're not constantly throwing down an anchor onto the reef in the popular areas. If you do use the anchor, because sometimes if you're going to certain areas, there are no anchored mooring balls available, you want to make sure that the boat you're selecting is reef-friendly and chooses to only anchor in sand beds instead of on the reef. It is so sad when you see a boat anchor landing on the reef instead of a sand bed, because it just crunches the coral underneath of it. And then they're meant to prevent the boat from drifting away. So there's lots of tugging and pushing and pulling that goes on that anchor that's coming from the boat above. Not only is it the initial impact of the anchor hitting the reef that causes significant damage, but it's the continual pressure and rubbing and crunching of that anchor the entire time that boat is anchored there. It's going to cause all kinds of damage on the reef. Boat operators should also not be making any decisions that are risky for local wildlife. That includes approaching certain species within too close of a distance. Here in Hawaii, whales, dolphins, and seals are all protected by the state, and you're actually not allowed legally to approach them within a certain distance, but it doesn't mean that boaters don't sometimes push their luck. So make sure that when you are hiring a boat operation, or if you are out boating here in Hawaii, that you are very respectful of those rules, give those animals their distance, not only because it's the law, but because ethically you want to make sure that you give them plenty of space. Additionally, you want to make sure that those tourism operators, those boat operators, are not doing anything that's going to put the reef at risk. Nothing that's going to be driving too fast in shallow areas or coming in too shallow and potentially rubbing the bottom of the boat or the hull against the reef, essentially crashing into the reef. Sounds crazy, I know, but believe me, the only reason I'm saying it is because it has happened. Even though it does come with a hefty fine, the damage is already done. It's irreversible, so it's better to choose somebody that doesn't do that in the first place. I know this one is a little bit tougher in order for you to determine, unless you're already out there and experiencing that situation, but sometimes you can go on to like TripAdvisor, or go look up some reviews, or even if you just go around the island and just ask the locals, like, hey, who do you recommend? Like, I'm looking for a low impact, sustainable, and reef friendly business, and usually they'll give you a couple really good options. Okay, so that is all that was on the at the ocean list that I had for you. So those are all the things that you can do if you are literally at the reef, if you're on the beach or at the reef. But what about if you live 1,000 miles away from the ocean? Like, what are some things that you can do if you are not physically at the ocean at the time? So the next section of this video is going to be the at home section, and we're going to be going into all of the different things that you can do in order to help the ocean and help the reef from your own home.